Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Dartmouth College's annual keynote address in honor of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. My name is Dr. Chloe Poston, and I am the Associate Vice President in the Office of Institutional Diversity and Equity. I have the pleasure of serving as your MC this evening. We're thrilled to be joined by a very limited in-person audience, in addition to the hundreds of you who are joining us via live stream. Before we begin, I would like for us to all pause for a moment. There have been several people who were social justice advocates, scholars, ministers, and people who have been steeped in this work who we've lost over the past year. So please join me in this moment of remembrance. Thank you. Please note that we do have a live captioner, and if you would like to access the captions, you will need to click on the CC button on the lower right-hand corner of your stream. As this is one of many events scheduled to take place this month in honor of King's legacy, I wish to extend a heartfelt thank you to the MLK committee, as well as the conferences and events team, who have worked with leadership from Kara Walker to develop an outstanding slate of programs this month. Tonight, we are thrilled to hear from Dr. Robert Harvey. He will be introduced by Dr. Chante Delalu, followed by remarks from Kayla Hester, who's class of 24. Excuse me, the mask fog is happening, sorry. Kayla Hester is a declared women, gender, and sexuality studies major with a minor in human-centered design. She is from the south suburbs of Chicago and is passionate about social activism, urban planning, and developing assistive technology for individuals with disabilities, youth, and the elderly. She is committed to working with companies to improve diversity, equity, and inclusion standards and practices. In addition to serving as the current president of the Afro-American Society, she serves on the executive board of Dartmouth's NAACP chapter and is a volunteer for the Dartmouth Alliance for Students of Color. Please join me in welcoming Kayla to the podium.
I have a dream that one day on the Red Hills of Georgia, the sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood. These words were spoken by Martin Luther King Jr. in front of the Washington Monument in 1963. We are gathered here today, neither in Washington, D.C., nor Georgia, but as descendants of formerly enslaved people, former slave owners, and immigrants from across the globe to celebrate the legacy of Dr. King. In 2020, countries began to suffer from an ongoing pandemic. This pandemic not only exposed to citizens what we've already known, that cash really does rule everything around us, but that our livelihood relies on our compassion for our brothers and sisters. And for Black Americans, there was an even larger pandemic that they've been fighting since the invention of race, racism itself. We, as a country, have watched the West Coast burn with forest fires, the South be torn through by hurricanes, and lives lost both to COVID-19 and police brutality. But we have also seen the country come together at a much needed time. Black Americans across the United States, in MLK's words, felt the sweltering heat of oppression and chose to confront it. We watched so many people stand up for those who couldn't, with names like George Floyd and Breonna Taylor filling the air. This year's theme is Uniting for Equity. When Kara reached out to me, I truly didn't know what I was gonna say. So I hope you're able to follow along and take something away from this. Equity, as we understand, has to do with recognizing the differences in every individual's circumstances and distributing resources based on need. Equity, in theory, supports the minority by eliminating barriers and creating equal opportunities. We see companies across the globe developing new standards and practices under the guise of diversity, equity, and inclusion. But what does this mean when faces of these corporations don't reflect the consumers? And similarly, what does this mean for institutions that do not have professors that reflect the student population? As a low-income Black student at Dartmouth, it wasn't very easy to feel at home. I was scared of being perceived as just another statistic for diversity numbers because I didn't have the same vocabulary as my peers and I don't wear L.L. Bean. I felt pressured to code switch and pretend to be someone I wasn't in order to feel accepted. I quickly realized that a sense of belonging isn't really a sense of belonging if you have to do anything other than be yourself to feel it. I joined organizations like the Afro-Am, NAACP, and DAC, hoping to find a community like the one I had at home. Being in my second year now, I've taken courses with wonderful professors and formed great relationships with them all, but none of them have been Black outside of the African and African-American studies professors. It's very hard to imagine yourself in a position where it looks like no one's been there before. While Dartmouth has plans to increase faculty diversity, I want to set the record straight that we absolutely can have professors in departments like physics and music that are Black because there are stories in those departments that deserve to be told as well. Dr. King was a man of principle, as one of my dear friends would describe it. His values manifested across different aspects of his life, which is why I'd like to take a small amount of time to bring to light two student-led organizations on campus that I think are important because they represent stories in the fight for equity right here in Dartmouth. The first being the Student Worker Collective, and the second being Dartmouth's Asian American Student Collective. Both groups' missions reflect Dr. King's beliefs and exemplify the need for more change even within our community. The Student Worker Collective has been working endlessly, and this is only the beginning, to organize and unionize dining workers on campus. The Asian American Student Collective have been fighting for an Asian American Studies department, which is also much needed representation. Regardless of our individual identities, we as a community should come together and realize what's happening right now. While you might not identify with the struggles of your peers, we cannot ignore what's happening right in front of us. As Dr. King said, we may have all come on different ships, but we're in the same boat now. I encourage you to be curious about the experiences of others and learn how you can be an ally in struggle. I know I've thrown a lot of quotes at you tonight, but I would like to leave you with one final quote from Dr. King from a sermon he gave after Bloody Sunday occurred. A man dies when he refuses to stand up for that which is right. A man dies when he refuses to stand up for justice. A man dies when he refuses to take a stand for that which is true. So after tonight, or even on your way to bed tonight, I challenge you to think about what you believe is right. Consider the steps you've taken to live that belief. And if you haven't taken any, I encourage you to make that change, no matter how small. After all, you must crawl before you walk. Thank you.
Thank you, Kayla, for those remarks. Next, we'll hear from Dr. Shantae Delalu. Shantae Delalu is the Senior Vice President and Senior Diversity Officer at Dartmouth College. Reporting to the President and serving on the Senior Leadership Team, she is a thought partner and subject matter expert responsible for planning, implementing, and evaluating Dartmouth's diversity, equity, and inclusion efforts, as well as overseeing the compliance programming related to civil rights. She holds an adjunct assistant professorship in African and African American studies, where her research explores the history of racial categorization and the dichotomy that arises for African and Caribbean students who are racialized in a U.S. context. Prior to Dartmouth, Shantae served as Vice President for Institutional Equity and Diversity at Brown University, overseeing their $165 million Diversity Action Plan. In her career, Shantae has worked in admissions, advising, counseling, as well as international and multicultural affairs in Maine, Alaska, Rhode Island, and now New Hampshire. Shantae hails from New Jersey and is a proud first-generation college graduate. She is a member of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority, Incorporated, and serves as a member of the University of Maine Board of Visitors and the Community Preparatory Schools Board of Trustees. In July, she will begin her first term as commissioner for the New England Commission of Higher Education. Please join me in welcoming Shantae to the stage.
Good evening, good evening, good evening. Thank you all for being here. A warm hello to the virtual audience and the members who are here today. Thank you for the introduction, Chloe, and really a huge thank you to Kayla. Over my years in education, it's been students who have kept me on my toes, but also thinking about this work and expanding it and making sure that we tell the truth. And what I heard in your remarks was not only the truth, but authenticity. That in order to bring our full selves, we have to just let everything else go and show up. And so I appreciate everything you share. On behalf of the President's Division and President Phil Hanlon, I send very warm welcome to our virtual audience members, as well as the invited guest here with us this evening. I am Shantae Delalu. I learned a long time ago, even if you are very eloquently introduced, you always say your name and affirm your place in a space. Every year, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. celebration here at Dartmouth is an opportunity for our community and communities around the country to celebrate the life and legacy of a man who died in pursuit of justice. This year is special because, as many of you know, it marks the 60th anniversary of King's visit to campus back on May 23rd, 1962. Currently, the campus organizers selected the theme of Uniting for Equity, which I think is very fitting because it illustrates that this is not one person's job to do, but rather a collective responsibility to combat injustice. Members of our community put on a plethora of events throughout the month of January, not just on one day. I strongly believe that following the racial violence in this country in the summer of 2020, which, by the way, is not new, it persists, these events have taken on a greater meaning. Let's continue to use this time to celebrate King and commit to doing the hard work of fighting equity all year long. I cannot think of a better keynote than Dr. Robert S. Harvey to give us our charge. Dr. Robert S. Harvey is an educator, a writer, a public scholar, an art enthusiast, a community leader, and a child advocate. Drawing upon lived experiences, ethical thought, and a bold vision for the future of human well-being, his leadership, writing, and being as threefold focus, love, justice, and hope. He is currently superintendent of East Harlem Scholars Academies, a community-based network of public charter schools in New York City, and chief academic officer of East Harlem Tutorial Program. He is also a visiting professor in the practice of public leadership at Memphis Theological Seminary. Dr. Harvey has committed himself to lifelong learning through a doctorate in leadership and society from Memphis Theological Seminary, a Master of Theological Studies from Harvard University, a Bachelor of Arts from Bryant University. He also earned a Certificate of School Management and Leadership from Harvard's Graduate School of Education. He completed the Harvard Institute for Superintendents. We have degrees here too at Dartmouth. And completed an executive program in arts and culture strategy with the National Arts Strategies and the University of Pennsylvania. He is author of Abolitionist Leadership in Schools, Undoing Systemic Injustice Through Communally Conscious Education, which works from an abolitionist lineage to guide education and community-based leaders in providing preemptive, premeditated, and progressive leadership while countering the impacts of racism that endure in our schools and communities. In the spring of 2022, his second book will be released, Teaching as Protest, Emancipating Classrooms Through Racial Consciousness. In reference to his book, Abolitionist Leadership in Schools, he states, it's an intentional vacillation between or weaving together of academic prose, sermonic verse, lived encounters, airplane conversations, and personal narratives, which centers on his belief about the commitment to Black storytelling as a historically relevant and abolitionist literacy tactic. At heart, the task of abolition is to imagine and actualize freedom as a humanizing experience for those who have only known enslavement, conquest, oppression, injustice, subjugation, and hegemony. On a personal note, I've known Dr. Harvey before he was officially Dr. Harvey, although I'm pretty sure I was referring to him as Doc in my head the whole 14 years. We met 14 years ago, and I instantly knew two things. We would always remain in contact, and his intellectual prowess would not only lead to advanced degrees and publications, but was a life calling and a gift. In referencing his own childhood and the traditions that have fueled his quest towards freedom, he writes, "As a child, I was surrounded by Black justice-centered, freedom-loving folks who were pursuing the abolition of every angle of lived experience. Born out of and raised within this tradition was my pursuit of freedom." Lucky for us this evening, he has graciously accepted our invitation to take us on a journey today. Please join me in welcoming to the podium Dr. Robert S. Harvey.
Good evening to all of you all. It's a pleasure to be here. It is my signal honor to be with you, the Dartmouth community, and to those of you within this region, and those of you globally who are joining us virtually for this Martin Luther King Jr. celebration. To the president of this college and his travels, to the senior leadership, the administrators, the faculty, the staff, the students, and to each and every one of you locally and globally, thank you for receiving me in this space. To Kara for her administrative prowess and radical humanity and shepherding the complexity of my life to get me here, thank you for spending some time with me. And most individually and particularly to the radically humanizing and justice expanding Senior Vice President and Senior Diversity Officer of this great institution, Dr. Shante Delalu, who I believe is literally one of the highest embodiments of human justice in this world. And in this work, I honor you. Can you do me a favor and help me celebrate Dr. Delalu? For the time that is ours to share together, with a quick footnote that I was raised in the Black Baptist tradition, and so my voice might modulate and a rhythm might get created, and you just roll with me as we work out this thing together. I want to spend time thinking about the words from John Coltrane, "A Love Supreme." In 1984, Anna Mae Bullock, a native of Brownsville, Tennessee, who spent formative years in St. Louis, Missouri, my hometown, better known to each and every one of you as Tina Turner, released her first and only Billboard number one single. 3 minutes and 48 seconds of raspy, infused, battle-weary, sophisticatedly cynical, and undoubtedly vulnerable perfection, selling over 1 million copies worldwide in one of the shortest spans of Billboard history. At that time, age 44, she became the most envied solo female artist to top the Billboard charts, earning a Grammy for Record of the Year, Song of the Year, and Best Female Pop Vocal Performance. This single, performed in the key of G sharp with a tempo of 98 beats per minute in common time, transposed to B flat minor after the second chorus, became the title descriptor of her biological film, becoming the battle cry of women all across the world. Tina Turner bellowed from the depths of a wounded soul, "What's love got to do with it? What's love but a secondhand emotion? You can talk to me in the room. What's love got to do with it? Who needs a heart when a heart can be broken?" Against the backdrop of 12 months of a global pandemic wrestling with the social, racial, political, and epidemiological reckoning that has brought all of us face to face with masked truths about the compounding complexities of inhumanity, inequality, injustice, and incompetence, what's love got to do with it? Against the canvas of a rising death toll where millions of lives across this globe and hundreds of thousands of lives here in our great nation were lost to a devastating virus compounded by the devastating political jocosity within the United States Congress, controlled by blue yet anxious to act against the bloody red hands willing to sustain conditions of suppression and silencing. What's love got to do with it? Against the backdrop of longing for the touch of loved ones, not being able to reach out and touch someone's hand, longing to live beyond mask, longing for the imagination and settling of a new normal, and longing for the return of authentic community that the enslaved folks actually knew what it meant to be community. What's love got to do with it? If I had a moment to spend time with Ms. Turner, I would have to tell her that after years of navigating the persecuting complexities of what it means to be human and Black in this country, love has everything to do with it. Because love is more than a secondhand emotion, because love is indeed, for our time together, the embodied and enfleshed ethic of justice. It is then of no surprise to submit that we are experiencing in our nation in this moment of human history what I am calling a crisis of lovelessness. And by this, I mean something more than a failure of respectability and a failure of politeness. I mean something more than a failure to be kind to me and to see me, but something much more about who we take ourselves to be in this nation. Who we see ourselves to be, who we claim to be, how we hear ourselves, and who we experience within. Shadowing the words of Francis Scott Key in 1814, or the land of the free and the home of the brave, is a question in my mind of what would it mean for us in this nation to stop being so concerned about being brave and start being concerned about being lovers. It is in my mind that love registers and functions as something bigger than, deeper than, profounder than, wiser than, even holier than a deep sense of affection and tenderness in the human condition. Love transcends all of that. Love registers and functions as what I'm calling tonight a kind of emo polytheological ethic, this embodied way of emoting and talking and doing justice as an extension of what it means to believe that every human is sacred. Love is a kind of moral invitation that invites you to probe the contours of your being, but not just our being, but our doing. Love is this kind of legal internal interrogation of the ways our thoughts and our words and our bodies either heal or harm, free or enslave, welcome or unwelcome, speak to or speak against. Because there's something about love that sounds different from the heart of those who know the other song called Rejected. Love, in the words of John Dewey, is a kind of animating mold of moral judgment that is feeling our way beyond the narrow considerations of self-interest and self-comfort and committed to taking up the burdens of those who are on the underside of power. That might be why Dr. King said in 62 and in 57, in his sermon called Conquering Self-Centeredness, an individual has not begun to live until they can rise above the narrow horizons of their individualistic concerns. And this is one of the big problems of life, he says, that so many of us never quite get to the point of rising above ourselves. And as an instrument with capacity to bend the moral arc of the universe from self-centeredness and self-preservation, from self-interest and self-absorption, I believe, Dr. Delalue, that love has everything to do with that. Because if you claim to love Black folks and brown folks, if you claim to love indigenous folks and queer folks and trans folks and unhoused folks and marginalized folks and underpaid folks and overworked folks, if you claim to love, You got to do something about it. Your love must call you to ask and answer, how has my love for the oppressed actualized with evidence that revolts against systems of evil? You must ask and answer the question every day. How has my love for the oppressed actualized with evidence of dismantling institutional and communal slums that damn people on the underside of my own power? Your love must ask and answer, how has my love for the activists come with some evidence to not only make room at the table, but to build whole new tables completely? Your love must call you to ask and answer, how has my love kept me from putting my work on the backs of oppressed folks? Because love, namely the love that we're talking about, King says is a love that black folks are born with, but he says it's a love that must be taught to white, well-meaning, well-intentioned liberals. Because King says that a love that satisfies justice with acts of the hand and not merely with adorations of the mouth becomes a kind of love that extends beyond the comfort of your office and into the places where oppressed folks are existing. King says to only give us love from your mouth but not with your hand is to treat black folks a little more than one would treat one's pet, he says in 1957. It is our call tonight then for a love supreme in the world, a love supreme in the region, a love supreme in this state, a love supreme on this campus that refuses to see the pursuit of liberation as mouth work only, but is committed to seeing the pursuit of liberation as the work of the hand. And when you see liberation as the work of the hand and the mouth, your mouth will never allow you to say the liberation is ever too hard, too much, too fast, or too complicated. Because love that embodies and enfleshes justice is a love that is willing to do anything necessary to realize itself. I can imagine that after watching newsreel on top of newsreel of death and destruction and division, it is easy to find ourselves to sit in this room tonight with a kind of gloomy sensibility of what this world can become. I can imagine that it is hard on a place like the beautiful Dartmouth campus to imagine an America that does not know how to love. But I can assure you that beyond the beauty of this campus, there is a world that is wrestling with a lovelessness, a kind of lovelessness that is hoping to envision what Dr. Ashan Crawley calls an otherwiseness. That kind of otherwiseness that our grandmama talked about, that kind of otherwiseness that grounds you from day to day, the kind of otherwiseness that gives you hope when what you see in front of you is not what you want to see. And I wonder, in these gloomy times, can you make space tonight to reclaim and to embody a kind of love that allows you to see hope in this ongoing democratic experiment? It was bell hooks, black feminist social prophet and democratic healer, who told the philosopher George Yancey in 2015 that the only way into being able to connect with others and to know how to be and to know how to see what we cannot see is by participating in every aspect of your life as a sacrament of love. This idea of participating in the pursuit of justice as a function of sacrament, it just does something for me. Because sacrament is this ancient spiritual idea of an outward and visible sign of an inward mystery. I hope you didn't miss that in the room. It's an outward sign. It's something you can see and touch and taste and feel, but you only can see, touch, and taste and feel it because something's working inside of you. The sacrament of love, then, embodied and enfleshed, is one that compels an outward sign. What does that mean? It means love is seen. Love is heard, love is hailed, love is written, love is sung, love is protest, love is marching, love is activism, love is making room, love is expanding the table, love is pulling up chairs, love is inviting voices. In short, can I help you? Love has evidence. As a sacrament of justice for those in power, those in privilege and those in possession of policy, committed to the work of actualizing freedom on campuses and in schools, in neighborhoods and in nations. We must have a kind of love that is not only content with being talked about, but a love that is demonstrated through outward and visible signs that you have a commitment to inward mystery, moral obligation, and even a kind of solemn discontent. When you love with evidence, it should make you frustrated sometimes. When you love with evidence, it should make you question your motives sometimes. When you love with evidence, it should push you to say, how can I do more, be more, show up more sometimes? In a world that is wrestling with a lovelessness for blackness, a lovelessness for brownness, a lovelessness for queerness, and almost all forms of otherness that are not the ones in power, it is a reminder for us then, particularly for those who wear the emblem of ally, accomplice, and co-conspirator, to take the sacrament of love seriously as a weighty precondition that here it is, love that has evidence is love that never tries to seek a refuge of safety. Because love with evidence knows that love that has the evidence of justice is not safe work. But love that has the evidence of justice, it's gritty work. It's painful work. It's uncomfortable work. And maybe that's why James Baldwin said that love does not begin and end the way we seem to think it does. James said that love is a battle. Love is a war. Love is a growing up. I would contend that the sacrament of love then, firstly, is costly. The moral imperative of a sacrament of love that has everything to do with everything is about a kind of love that grows you up through the battling shadows of conquering your own self-centeredness. A love that costs you something is a kind of love that grows you up through the warring words of what Barry White says, when you learn how to practice what you preach. And I wonder how many of you, if you took an inventory of the sacrament of love in your life that is not in this room, would you be able to testify that you are the embodiment of a risky love that refuses to play it safe because you want to be grown up? Or would you have to admit in the mirror of life that you are the embodiment of a safe love, a kind of love that comforts you and holds you and invites you to stay the same? The kind of love that grows us up is not safe, because that would be what Niebuhr calls cheap love, purchased on the auction block of neutrality to quell any sense of personal responsibility. Cheap love is the kind of love that maintains revolt and agitation at a distance by placing all the blame on the inept and the bungling of people we will never meet. But the kind of love that grows us up, the kind of love that grows up institutions, that grows up departments, that grows up faculties, that grows up administrations, that love is risky. It's risky because it's costly. As my grandmother would say, that it's going to always cost you to love somebody. That means that when we cultivate a state of sacramental love for the ignored ones in a place, we cultivate a kind of love that allows us to pay whatever price is necessary to ensure that the ignored and the disregarded, the unsung and the overpowered are seen, held, and resourced. Paying the price of costly love is when you are willing to unnerve and upset the self-centered comforts of people who are closest to you, the ones that live on your streets, sit on your pews, golf at your social clubs, frequent your restaurants, and sometimes even spend time in your homes. Paying the price of a costly love is when we are willing to call in and call out every microaggression, every micro insult, and every micro invalidation, even if it means losing good grace, good access, and good gifts. Costly love is a love when we are willing to put decision-making power in the hands of those closest to their own oppression. Because what we know is that if you've never been in that place, you don't know how to calculate what is best for those people. But love is not just costly, love is urgent. The moral imperative of the sacrament of love as being urgent is often one of the barriers to justice, because America is continuing to live out what X calls a theory of delayed time, in which those in power, those in privilege, and those with policy assume and demand that freedom should occur, but it should occur on a pre-written schedule. From the institution of American chattel slavery to the abolitionist participation of white organizations here in the North, to Lincoln's civil promise of emancipation, to the undoing of Jim Crow, to the desegregation of Brown v. Board, to the Voting Rights Act of 65, and now even to the John Lewis Act. People always say it'll happen in time. But I wonder, what would it look like for cities and states and regions and colleges and universities and corporations to stop saying in the name of love, wait just a little while longer, before experiencing a kind of sacrament that realizes that in the name of freedom, urgency matters. In 1963, in his letter from a Birmingham city jail written to white clergymen, calling his efforts unwise, untimely, and too bold, King replied with words that still stand today. He said, "For years now, I've heard the word wait. It rings in the ear of every Negro with piercing familiarity. This wait has almost always meant never. We must come to see that justice too long delayed is justice denied. On the basis of costly love, telling oppressed folks to wait, telling marginalized folks that we need to take our time, telling oppressed folks that we're working on it year after year after year, telling oppressed folks it'll happen eventually, it is a kind of ugliness that stains our sense of hope and it blemishes our sense of truth. Because a community that works for everybody is a community that is urgent for everybody. This idea of urgency grounds itself in a mid-15th century Latin concept which denotes that something is not only pressing, but something is necessary. What would it feel like if we reimagined using the word urgent, not being about time, but being about significance? That's why the sacrament of love, as embodied and in flesh justice, must be urgent, because to act in ways that are unenthusiastic and lackadaisical is to whisper into the souls of oppressed folks, your voice is unnecessary, your dignity is unnecessary, and your freedom is unnecessary. And maybe that is a richer reading of Black Lives Matter, is that it is a call to say that not only do our lives matter, but our lives matter and they are necessary. When love has everything to do with everything, you are compelled by a kind of justice that is no longer delayed by assuming that it is only through a strategic plan can we create the conditions for belonging to occur. When love has to do with everything, you are called by a kind of justice that is no longer delayed by assuming that heart work and head work and hand work are mutually exclusive and one must happen before the other. When love is costly, you are called by a kind of justice that is no longer delayed by placating to the pleasantries of digestible supremacy culture merely because it's not dressed with white sheets. When love is committed to justice, you are called by a kind of justice that is no longer delayed by assuming that token faces are signs of righteousness. They are not radical and they are not revolutionary. In an age of mattering, where we have a moral and ethical responsibility to create conditions for oppressed folks, oppressed needs, and oppressed demands to matter, we have exhausted our theories of delay and must now do the work of living a theory of urgency. And lastly, not only is costly love urgent, not only is the sacrament of love costly, but love always brings with it a sense of becoming. Now, I must be careful when I use the word becoming, because if I am not careful, you will hear the word becoming and you will think about improvements, adjustments, edits, and modifications. And the reason I must be careful is because love, when it is embodied, is not an edit. Love is not a modification. Love is not an improvement. But the sacrament of love that has the evidence born of it is about a kind of individual and communal becoming in the radical sense that alters the very core of how we see the world, how we see our institutions, and how we experience our lives within those places. As extensions of a costly love and an urgent love, the lives of King and Hamer, Baldwin and Morrison, El Shabazz and Baker, Tubman and Truth, Douglas and Turner were not lived for this nation to be edited. No, they were not lived for democracy to be modified. They were not lived for justice to be altered, but they were lived in ways as an incarnated calling for this nation to be made brand new. That's because for the sacrament of love, becoming is not a modification. Becoming is a complete metamorphosis. And we know that a metamorphosis is a kind of complete, conspicuous, and relatively abrupt change in form, in structure, and in substance. In other words, the kind of love that radically alters who gets to engage in freedom, who gets to access policy, and who gets to benefit from dignity is a kind of love that is willing to completely and conspicuously change its very essence. Love as a metamorphosis is the kind of love that is less concerned with how it looks and more concerned with how it acts. It is less concerned with its theatrics and more concerned with its tenets. It is less concerned with its investigations and it is concerned with its investments. That is why in the Metamorphoses, comprising 11,995 lines, 15 books, and 250 myths, written in 8 AD by the Roman poet Ovid, he says, "I intend to speak of forms that are only changed into new entities." And for Ovid, at the core of this idea of metamorphoses, of something being changed into the new, there were only two options. There was the god of violence, and there was the god of love. And ultimately, Ovid underscores that a metamorphosis that is sustained is only one grounded in deep love. For those of us today committed to liberation, it proposes that in the embodiment of a justice that's going to transform an entire collegiate community, a kind of justice that will transform a city and a region, a justice that transforms relationships, and a justice that transforms individuals. Some people will choose violence, but we have a right to choose love. And I wonder if we took a moral evaluation of the sacrament of love sweeping across the 269 acres of this beautiful place, would we experience a community living a justice as a modification? Or would we experience a community living out a justice of metamorphosis? Today is the right day for people committed to love in pursuit of something humane to change the wrong into right. Today is a great day to make a decision to change the unjust into the just. Today is a great day to change exclusive into inclusive, from closed doors to open doors, from access for the few to access for the many. Today is a great day to change what has been delayed to what is now urgent. Today is a great day to change what has been cheap into that which is now costly. By creating the conditions in this community, within a community, where we talk love, hear love, and do love in ways that don't just educate the most promising students and prepare them for a lifetime of learning, but works with those promising students at the margins of society, walking alongside those students subjugated by supremacy and working with those students embodying and enfleshing a costly and urgent love, one that can only be achieved through righteous, radical, and revolutionary creation of liberation. Then and only then can we catalyze a metamorphosis that doesn't just make Dartmouth better, but King would say it makes it new. And so I have one question, which is, how will you bend the moral arc of this universe toward justice for humans from every land? How will you all make a decision to bend the arc of the moral universe for Black folks and for brown folks, for indigenous folks and for Asians, for migrants and for refugees, for young folks and old folks, for queer folks and non-binary folks, for women and children, for incarcerated folks and unhoused folks, for students and faculty, for can afford to pay and no means to pay, for administrators and policymakers? How will you bend justice for frontline workers and first responders? How will you bend justice for nurses and social workers? How will you do justice for caregivers and counselors, for security guards and culinary support, for cashiers and carpenters? How will you decide to do justice? Will it be costly? Will it be cheap? Will it be delayed? Or will it be urgent? Will it be an edit? Or will it be made new? Only you can answer those questions. But I know one thing to be true, that whatever you decide, love has something to do with it. Love is the only way it'll happen. And when you make a decision for it to be costly, for it to be made new, for you to become a new being, and for it to be urgent, I believe then only will you qualify to sing with John Coltrane, that you've achieved a love supreme. Thank you.
Now, there we go. All right. Thank you so much for those riveting remarks. Really appreciate the challenge of centering love in the work that we're doing here at Dartmouth. So thank you again. Thank you. We'll transition now to Q&A facilitated by Dr. Delalu.
Woo. Now, we all need a minute to just take that in. So I'm going to give us a moment here because it is... I try to envision, after reading Dr. King's 1962 Towards Freedom speech, what was it like to be in Dartmouth Hall 105, overflowing crowd? Mm. And as you talked, I said, I felt it. Mm. I was there, right? I'm looking at his speech, and he said, we have to focus on love. He broke it down. Yeah. The Greek language is three forms of love. Right?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
So here we are 60 years later, and you're centering the same thing because injustice persists, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. But the way to address it hasn't changed.
Right, right.
That's what I heard. I heard many things in what you said.
Right.
But if we fundamentally go back to love, that we can actually really move this thing.
Yeah.
So the other thing that resonated that was connected to his speech here is he talked about the myth of time. And you talked about the urgency of this work. Mm-hmm. And so there's so many places to start, but let me just start for sake of time. And there was another thought that he raised that I know a lot of people in the community are interested in and curious about. And that was the myth of educational determinism. Mm. So he said that the idea that only education can solve a problem is a myth, like either this or that. He talked also about how both education and legislation is critical to moving this work.
Yeah.
So how do you see love infused in education and legislation?
Yeah, that's a great question. One of my critiques of the education-only reality is that it attempts to give people an easy out of a linear answer to liberation. Is that when we assume that there is one pathway that liberates all oppressed folks, it frees us from our individual responsibility of decentering our power and our privilege and our access on how we then get to control that one pathway. Mm. When we think about institutional access, if education was indeed the way forward, and if education was something we agreed to as the linear pathway, then why is it $80,000 a year? If education was indeed the pathway that we needed to liberate folks, then why do we have single-digit percentages that only allow certain folks to access certain kinds of it? It creates a way for us to then be able to use the one thing that we believe is the lever and then still build a whole system of subjugation around the lever we claim was the lever out. And so if love is indeed connected to education and education is indeed the pathway to liberation, then love has to free the shackle from education then being a sophisticated and degreed chattel system. And ultimately what we have done is we have turned what we believe to be the pathway into the most palatable form of chattel slavery. How do we pick who gets to represent us in this form? How do we put a price on that form? Are certain bodies worth more money than other bodies in this form? How do we ensure which forms of the body is discounted and not? And so I think King would be very critical, as would almost every civil rights luminary, that we never make a single destination the only pathway to liberation, because there are countless examples of how that one pathway have still failed Black and Brown and Indigenous and Asian and marginalized folks time after time after time. Mm-hmm. I have a dear friend of mine who runs a state prison-based graduate program. And if education was the only way, then let's talk about the high percentage of folks with education who are incarcerated for minor drug offenses.
Right.
So if education was indeed the only way to liberation, then we wouldn't have state prisons and city jails full of folks with degrees.
Thank you. So I jumped right into the questions, but let me say for our virtual audience and for our live audience, we had questions that were sent in advance. And so I will continue with a question that was sent in advance. And for those here, we do have a mic. I would just ask that you use social distancing. If you wanted to go to the mic and ask a question of Dr. Harvey, you're welcome to head to the mic and we will call on you. So let me go to, because it's right along, we had a question from Lisa, Dartmouth class of 94, who's currently an educator at a Quaker school in Philadelphia. She herself identifies as an abolitionist instructor. And you know, she talks about her school is diverse in many ways, committed to this work, and yet, and what she wrote was, and still, here we are. Her question is, what obligations or actions are required of independent schools in this moment? Mm-hmm. Is abolitionist education possible in these separate and unequal spaces?
Mm. Abolition, to me, is possible anywhere. Because for the reimagination of abolition, we often have used the word to be directly connected to deconstruction, the overturning of a thing, the complete getting rid of a thing. I propose in my text, abolition is not just about the elimination or the deconstruction of an institution, but it's about inverting that institution on its own power. How do you work from that? That's kind of the sociological outsider within concept, right? That abolition is when you are willing to go into places that are steeped in deep oppression and reimagine the ways of which power within works against itself. Mm-hmm. Independent schools, which I started my career in Independent Day and boarding schools have so much access to power and privilege that the way abolition can work in those spaces is, how do you invite people from those seats to experience and to see lived experience without pathologizing it, mm-hmm. and then decentering themselves in even telling the narrative of the young people that they serve? Abolition in those spaces also works with folks asking, when we think about endowment creation, what does it mean to sit on billions at times, dollars of an endowment, and yet there are young people and communities and spaces who don't have access to the wraparound realities of what it means to just be held as a human? How do you sit on millions and billions of dollars of an endowment and there are people who are unhoused at the periphery of your institution? How do you sit on millions and billions of dollars with massive million-dollar campaigns, and yet there are people who work for the institution that are unable to afford access to prescriptions? Mm-hmm. So abolition, to me, works from within by saying, how do we get risky? How do we get costly? Mm-hmm. How do we pay the price from within to ensure that, at minimum, the people within our ether are seen, held, heard, and resourced? Mm-hmm. To sit on $1 billion, millions of dollars, and to have people who are underpaid and overworked is the complete work of abolition, to flip that power, mm-hmm. so that at minimum the community is cared for while we rest on our laurels, mm-hmm. of increasing our assets.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Any questions yet from the live audience? If not, I'll continue with some questions from those in our virtual space, and thank you for continuing to tune in. This question pivots a little bit, but I think it's an important one that I'd like to raise. This person posited, they said, fewer Americans today are nominally affiliated with a church or organized religion, or engage in any kind of weekly attendance practice, etc. Does this weaken the force of King's work and influence, such as the letter from Birmingham jail, whose arguments derive from Christ, the Apostle Paul, Reinhold Niebuhr, St. Thomas Aquinas, Paul Tillich, and other biblical stories?
It's a great question. I mean, all of those folks that are named had a very common project, with the exception of Paul. I would take Paul out of that list, but beyond Paul, the rest of them are really wrestling with questions of what it means to be human. Mm-hmm. I think about Paul Tillich. Paul Tillich grounds his work on this idea that all of us are seeking what he calls the ground of being, mm-hmm. right? That is not about God. That is not a Judeo-Christian concept for him necessarily, but it's a concept of, like, what is my humanity grounded in that gives me value and that gives me value, but also gives me a sense of connectedness to all human creation, mm-hmm. right? And so I think the King's work transcends the Judeo-Christian context in which he writes, because ultimately even King says, in the privacy of letters that we don't often read, the letters that were unpublished until his death, that King was doing human work. Mm-hmm. It was why he was able to be influenced by folks like Gandhi, and why he was able to sit with the Dalai Lama and have conversation, because King was ultimately concerned with the sacred of all humanity. That if we center in on the sacred of all humanity, his chosen tradition does not limit his argument. Right? And that's why my conversation with folks, whether one is a Christian, one identifies as Jewish or Muslim or agnostic or a spiritualist or practices African indigenous religion or no religion at all, if we can start with the idea that all humans are sacred, sacred inherently by the matter of just being created, mm-hmm. by however they choose to believe the story of their own creation, if we believe that all humans have sacred value, if we start there, then we free ourselves from having to be grounded in any kind of particular religious affiliation, and also frees us to be able to even sit and have conversation with deeply righteous evangelicals who would try to connect this stuff to being about religion. This is not about religion. This is about the inherent value of the human person, and if we take that seriously, it is why I tend to use the idea of human justice versus social justice, uh-huh. that I'm trying to pursue a kind of human justice that does not require you to have any kind of work connected to it, but you are deserving of justice on the mere fact that you are human. Mm-hmm. And I think that that's partly what King's project was, a kind of human justice that he understood through a kind of Christo lens.
Great. You know, I want to ask a specific, let's stay on that, the human justice and the sense of being. And going back to Kayla's, the student's opening remarks, you know, there are people out there who identify as Black who are listening in, and they are maybe currently working in, studying in predominantly white spaces. And so I know I can speak for myself that at a certain point with the pandemic and the racial unrest, I had to reframe how I was engaging with the world and chose radical joy. And that really helped me to get up and continue to do this work. And I think it was really embedded in a lot of what you said tonight. So what kind of message do you have for those who do identify as the individuals who are underrepresented, but waking up every day having to do this work and live and be, right, in the midst of such pain?
So two things. One, I'm deeply influenced by something Baldwin said when he was in Turkey, which is that hope and joy must be invented daily. He goes on to say, you can lose it by the end of the day, but you get another day to invent it again. And my word, mostly to Black folks, is I wake up every day and I choose hope. The conditions of white supremacy culture put me to bed at night often, hopeless, but I choose it again. And I continue to choose hope, because to not choose hope is to live with a kind of antithesis to radical joy. It's to live in radical despair all day long. And when you are shaped and born out of a tradition of despair, choosing joy becomes what a friend of mine called, it becomes a political act. So I go into white spaces and I pick joy as a methodology to let the white system know, whiteness as a sociopolitical ethic, right? To let whiteness know I'm still here. I still deserve to be here. And like I said in that talk, and I am necessary. And that's why I wake up and choose hope every day. Because when the system sees me as being able to not be necessary, my choosing hope, my choosing joy, my choosing to show up even if I'm silent reminds you that I'm necessary. And I often tell the Black folks that I'm deeply connected to in predominantly white spaces, there is deep power in showing up and saying nothing. And that sometimes I reclaim my joy by answering that question of, Rob, do you have anything to offer? Not today. And that is a form of radical joy for me, to know that if I engage, I will end this day hopeless. So I choose not to, to maintain that I can go to bed with some semblance of peace in my life. And so I invite folks to always create the conditions by which their joy is never sacrificed on what I call in this book coming out, the altar of white convenience. And so that's what I choose to do.
Thank you. Look, you know, you just referenced your second book that's coming out, which I can't wait for. And connected to this question that was asked by someone in a virtual audience, thinking about Dr. King's last writings, how critical do you believe Black-owned press is for reporting narratives?
Yeah, I actually just finished a book called The Presidents Versus the Press that tracks the history of that intersection. And, you know, Black press is probably one of the most under-talked about realities, but one of the most needed realities in today's world. I think about personalities like April Ryan, who has survived five presidents as a White House press correspondent, and imagining the tensions and the realities of what it means to have to navigate an Obama and a Trump, a Bush and a Biden, and how that voice, when you are writing from a place of the underprivileged, when you are writing from oppression, you write from a kind of sensibility that understands the humanity of the topic, right, not just the implications that it has for policy, of the implications that it has for talking points, right? That to me is steeped in the Ida B. Wells tradition, right? The way that folks became so sensitized to the mass murder of Black bodies in the South was that Ida B. Wells knew how to write about it in a way that gave it humanity. It's what in book one is called, right? She had literary suasion. She knew how to use words as press to talk about swinging bodies bloodying the grass. If you've never understood what it means to be born out of a lineage of those bodies that stain that grass, you write with a kind of implication that can often be loveless. And so I see the Black press as being folks who know how to use the news to write love letters to Black people every time they write. And so I think the Black press is critical, but I feel the same way around papers like El Clamor, the initial Spanish-written paper in 1865 out in California. People born of oppression need a love letter through journalism written to them that transcends the gaze, Morrison's word, the gaze of the white right.
Okay, we are coming on the end, and I think, do anyone have a question in the audience? Any questions in the audience? Okay, I think we will. I'm going to end with one last question. I wish we can go on for another couple of hours. But your talk was compelling. It gave us, I think, all a clear charge, which is what I didn't know what you were going to talk about, but I knew it was. I tried to describe it to some colleagues, and I said, all I know is he's going to bring down a house. I can't. There's no other way to put it. And so one of the many things that stood out was the crisis of lovelessness.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And so we want to end on a positive note of hope, joy, love, justice.
Yeah.
So tell us in closing, what's the opposite of the crisis of lovelessness?
You know, the opposite of, I would say the antidote to the crisis of lovelessness is the canvas of expansiveness. That when we love institutionally, we are willing to put a new canvas on the easel every time somebody calls us out that the previous thing we painted didn't go far enough. If we are committed to love, you can call me out because that stroke was not the stroke where you felt seen, and I put a new canvas up. And so I think that the antidote to this crisis of lovelessness is being willing to ever reimagine how we create the conditions for every human to be seen, for every human to be held, and for every human to wake up and to create the conditions of hope that they need to be well in the space. And if we do that, I think the crisis goes away. And we all get to live to see the beauty of ourselves in spaces that we often don't see ourselves. So,
Thank you. I hope everyone enjoyed the program. It was incredibly remarkable. Thank you, Dr. Harvey, for clearing your schedule to spend some time with us here at Dartmouth. And I know you have some more commitments with us tomorrow. We look forward to those. To those in our virtual audience, thank you for tuning in. We do hope that you enjoyed the program. There's, a plethora of other programs happening at Dartmouth virtually through the end of the month. So please tune in. And for those in our audience, thank you for coming. Good night.